Prophecy I believe to come next is the Ten Kingdoms. 90% of all theologians believe the Ten Kingdoms to be 10 nations from Europe that are ruled from Rome and collectively known as the Revived Roman Empire. These theologians believe this also because of Revelation chapter 13 verse 3, where it says one of the heads have fallen, then miraculously come back to life. They say this is the Revived Roman Empire. So these theologians believe that the European Union is the Revived Roman Empire and the Antichrist will rule them, and then the tribulation starts. 90% of those theologians believe this. Since the fall of the Roman Empire,
most theologians believe there hasn't been a prophetic occurrence, and they are waiting for the Roman Empire to revive. That's the next timeline they're looking for.
So when the vision of the dry bones in Ezekiel was fulfilled in 1948, they got very excited. And they believe that prophecy was finally fulfilled, and they believe the European Union that was formed up was going to be the Revived Roman Empire. And that this generation would see the end of the world, which would have been 1988. And they were all wrong. And the ones that didn't believe that the end of the world would end in 1988 definitely believed that they would see the end of the world in their lifetime. Now, I don't agree with any of this. This is the way I believe it's going to happen. First, I don't believe in a hibernation period. I believe that prophecy was being fulfilled continually for the past 2,000 years. It has never stopped. Second, I don't believe in a revived Roman Empire.
And let me explain. We're going to start with Daniel 2. It's the vision of the statue with King Nebuchadnezzar. It's pretty familiar. If we start in verse 36, this is where Daniel interprets the statue. It's an overview of what's happening from the time of Daniel to the end of the age. We know the king is Babylon because he says it in verse 36, 37. So he is the head of gold. Now it says in verse 39, after you there will arise another kingdom inferior to you. And they don't name the kingdom. That's the arms and the breast. Then another third kingdom of bronze, which will rule over all the earth. That's the thighs there, the belly. Doesn't name a name. Then it's starting in verse 40. It says, there will be a fourth kingdom as strong as iron, inasmuch as iron crushes and shatters all things. So like iron that breaks in pieces, it will crush and break all these in pieces. And then it talks about the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron. It will be a divided kingdom. So it mentions here the toes. When he first interpreted it, it didn't mention toes, but now it does. So the toes become significant. And in that you saw the iron mixed with common clay, they will combine with one another in the seed of men, but they will not adhere to one another, even as iron does not combine with the clay. After the Roman Empire declined, all its territories were trying to represent Rome. And they were trying to unite all through the Middle Ages, kings and queens and princesses and the princes, their daughters, the dukes, the duchesses. They were all trying to marry other kingdoms and intermarriage so they can try to combine and unite and get strong. But as they say, it would never work. They would never unite again. Then in verse 44, God's kingdom, it is set up on the toes. It's because it says in the days of those kings. What kings are they talking about? The ten toes. God will come down and destroy and smash all those kingdoms. So the ten toes have to be here at the end times when God returns and sets up his millennium kingdom. So remember, this is an overview of from the time of Babylon to the end of the age. So you know there's going to be four kingdoms on earth. That's all it mentions. And it ends with ten toes at the bottom when God sets up his kingdom. That's all we know. Now let's move to chapter 7 of Daniel. This chapter parallels chapter 2. If you look at verse 3, it says four great beasts. And there was four empires on the statue. And then if you look, it goes on to describe what each beast was like. That just adds more description and more detail to your vision already. So we know that in chapter 2, Babylon, we know the first one was Babylon. It was the one that Daniel was living in. It was the one that took Jerusalem, destroyed the temple. That was the head of gold. And now it gives it a further description. The king of the animals, a lion with wings. Wings means swiftness. And it did conquer, Nebuchadnezzar conquered the Mesopotamia area pretty quick. So we know this represents Babylon. And in verse 4, it just gives more description of proof that it was Nebuchadnezzar when he became a man and was an animal. I don't need to go into all that. But then verse 5, and behold another beast, a second one. This represents the statue. And here it doesn't name it. It doesn't tell you who it is. It just tells you it resembles a bear and it was raised up on one side and three ribs were in its mouth between its teeth. And thus they said, arise, devour. So this corresponds with Medo-Persia. You don't know that yet. There's no names. But remember, prophecy tells you where you're at in a timeline or allows you to identify certain events when they take place. It's not telling you the future. So even though you don't know the name, we know through history it became this. But as for our study right now, we don't know who it is. We just know it represents the next empire on the statue. Silver, which is inferior to the gold. And then the bear, which is powerful, and the three ribs represent destroying three kingdoms. And the reason that it says the bear is raised up on one side, because it did start out as a Medes and Persian Empire, but the Persians, as you know, became dominant. Now let's look on the sixth verse. After this, I kept looking, and behold, another one, like a leopard, which had on its back four wings of a bird. The beast also had four heads, and dominion was given to it. So we know the next empire that came along was Greece. Again, it's not giving us any names right now. So Daniel, seeing his vision, he's not sure who these people are until it happens. He has no idea who these kingdoms would be. And the four heads represent Alexander's kingdom breaking up into four kingdoms. And the wings, again, and the leopard means with speed. I mean, he conquered basically a whole known world in little over 10 years. Now remember, in these prophecies here, Daniel is saying after this and after this. Remember in the statue, it starts at the head, it goes down, so it corresponds perfectly with the bronze statue part. Now we move into the iron leg parts, because in starting in verse 7, it says, after this I kept looking in the night visions, and behold a fourth beast, dreadful and terrifying and extremely strong, and it had large iron teeth. When it says iron teeth, I immediately go to the iron legs of the statue. It's talking about the same one. Then it said, it devoured and crushed and trampled down the remainder with its feet, and it was different from all the beasts that were before it. Now, you remember in the statue, it said it devoured and trampled down. It's the same language. This is the fourth empire on earth. Only it adds more detail here, because it says, it was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. Immediately, I think of the 10 toes when I read the 10 horns. It goes right down to the bottom of the statue, the last empire before God sets up his kingdom. Now, he says, while I was contemplating the horns, behold, another horn, a little one, came up among them. And three of the first horns were pulled out by the roots before it. And behold, this horn possessed eyes like the eyes of a man and a mouth uttering great boasts. Then he goes right to the ancient of days in verse 9, setting up his throne, just like in statue of Daniel 2. Now, if we go to verse 11, he kept looking because of the sound of the boastful words which the horn was speaking, until the beast was slain, his body was destroyed. So this identifies the person. We identify this person as some future antichrist. So we see here the 10 toes, the 10 horns represent the same thing. They have to be set up. Then the Antichrist shows up, and then God destroys him. Now, the controversial verse here in chapter 7 to me is verse 12, where it says, as for the rest of the beasts, their dominion was taken away, but an extension of life was granted to them for an appointed period of time. What I think that is since verse 7, Daniel is being explained about the fourth beast and about the little horn. And it goes on and on and on all the way till the end when it was destroyed and given to the burning fire at verse 11. So at verse 12, he's just reminding Daniel, hey, don't forget about the other beast, because he really didn't explain them in the beginning. He really explained the fourth beast. He's just saying, here's what's going to happen to the other beasts. Don't forget about them. Their dominion was taken away, but an extension of life was granted to them for an appointed period of time. All that is to me is the other beast, their life was taken away, right? The Babylonians were succeeded by the Persians. The Persians were succeeded by Alexander. And then this fourth terrible beast eventually takes over from the Greeks. There was a little period in between the Greeks and the Romans where some other countries like the kingdom of Pontus, Pergama, and even the Hasmoneans dynasty in Jewish had their independence. So, and then the Romans took over. So these beasts, even though their dominion was taken away, their power was gone, they are not eliminated from the world. It's not ready to be destroyed until when God destroys them at the end. That's why it says for an appointed period of time. That means all the culture, religious festivals, pagan worships, their society of Babylon was passed on to Persia. Persia was passed on to the Greeks, and the Greeks passed it on to the Fourth Empire. So even though their dominion's gone, they still have an extension of life. Their way of life and their ideas and thoughts were passed on all the way to the Fourth Empire. Now, starting in verse 15, Daniel is alarmed. He wants to know the exact meaning of what he just saw. And he's told, these great beasts, which are four in number, remember the statue had four, there's four here, are four kings who will rise from the earth. But the saints, they will receive the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever. But then he desired to know the exact meaning of the fourth beast, which was different from all the others, exceedingly dreadful, with its teeth of iron and its claws of bronze, and which devoured, crushed, and trampled down the remainder with its feet. And he wanted to know the meaning of the ten horns that were on its head, and the other horn which came up, and before which three of them fell. And you can keep reading, and it goes on and on about this horn had eyes, uttering great boasts, and it was warring against the saints and overpowering, and he will intend to make alterations in times and in law, and they will be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. Now this is the first mention we have of times, and we'll get into the times here in a little while, but time is a reference in biblical terms to a certain amount of passage. So the time, times, and a half a time, I'll just tell you right now, is a year. Times, plural, is 2 years, and the half is, so for 3.5 years, this little horn is going to wage war and speak out against the Most High. Well, who's the Most High? It's God. And who's doing that? Anybody who blasphemes or goes against God, which is going to be this little horn. But it goes on to say he's going to be taken away, annihilated, and destroyed forever. And of course, the kingdom again, he reminds us, that will be given over to the saints and God will rule. And this ends his vision of chapter 7. So to recap chapter 2 and chapter 7, we have four kingdoms. We're told, or we know, that the first one is Babylon the Great. That's the time that Daniel was living. That was the supreme empire that conquered Jerusalem, destroyed the temple. That is the all-powerful kingdom. The other three aren't given names yet, but we do know that the fourth one on earth is more dreadful and powerful than all the others, and it will end up in 10 kingdoms. And there will be a little horn that comes up among the 10, destroys three of them, and will rule for 3.5 years. Then God will come and destroy these kingdoms and set up his. That's what we understand from chapter 2 and chapter 7. Let's look at chapter 8. Now, starting in chapter 8, And verse 3, then I lifted my eyes and looked, and behold, a ram which had two horns was standing in front of the canal. Now the two horns were long, but one was longer, and the other with the longer one coming up last. I saw the ram budding westward, northward, and southward, and no other beast could stand before him, nor was there anyone to rescue from his power, but he did as he pleased and magnified himself. Now starting in verse 20, it gives you the ram's identity. This is the first time we have the animal's identity other than Babylon. The ram, which you saw with the two horns, represents the kings of Media and Persia. So now we know there's Babylon. Daniel knows that Persia is going to come next with the kings of Media and Persia. And the reason there's two horns, one longer, one short, and it goes along with chapter 7, the bear leaning on one side, is because Persia eventually came up after Media and took over Media and became the stronger. Now Persia headed in three directions: westward, which was the conquering of Lydia, northward, which was conquering of Media, and southward, which they conquered Babylon. This represents the bear, remember, holding three ribs in his mouth, and he was allowed to conquer. Those are three empires he conquered: Lydia, Media, and Babylon. Now verse 5, while I was observing, behold, a male goat was coming from the west over the surface of the whole earth without touching the ground, and the goat had a conspicuous horn between his eyes. He came up to the ram that had the two horns, which I had seen standing in front of the canal, and rushed at him in his mighty wrath. I saw him come besides the ram, and he was enraged at him. And he struck the ram and shattered his two horns, and the ram had no strength to withstand him. Move up to verse 21, and we have the identity of the goat. The shaggy goat represents the kingdom of Greece, and the large horn that is between his eyes is the first king. So just as we've seen in 7, the leopard with the wings flying fast, it moves. Here it says it came west over the surface of the whole earth without touching the ground. It was speed. Alexander the Great was his first king, and he conquered Persia within like a little over 10 years. It was remarkable. Then it says the male goat magnified himself exceedingly, but as soon as he was mighty, the large horn was broken, and in his place there came up four conspicuous horns toward the four winds of heaven. So Alexander, at the height of his power, died, and his empire eventually fell to his four generals. That's where the four horns come from. Now let me make a note. As we're using animals here, the Jews would recognize right away the ram and the goat. Those are more sacrificial lambs that the Jews used. They would notice that right away. The horns, known as shofars, they used in their festivals. Now during the fall, the Jewish holidays of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur is when the goats and the rams would be sacrificed for the people's iniquities and transgressions. I believe this is God's spiritual mandate against the Jews, that he is bringing desolation upon the Jews for their iniquities and transgressions, and I'll show you that. Now let's start at verse 9. It talks about a little horn. Now right away, when you see this little horn, doesn't it bring you right back to chapter 7 in verse 8? Where he says, I was contemplating the horns, behold, another horn, a little one, came up among them. So yes, these are referenced the same type of idea with this little horn. Now they are different because the one in chapter 7 comes up after the 10 kingdoms at the end times. This one comes up, it says in chapter 8, verse 8, the large horn was broken. In its place there came up four conspicuous horns toward the four winds of heaven. Then on 9, out of one of them, so this comes out of the four horns, came forth a rather small horn which grew exceedingly great towards the south, towards the east, and towards the beautiful land. It grew up to the host of heaven and caused some of the host and some of the stars to fall to the earth. It trampled them down. It even magnified itself to be equal with the commander of the host. And it removed the regular sacrifice from him, and the place of his sanctuary was thrown down. And on account of transgression, the host will be given over to the horn along with the regular sacrifice, and it will fling truth to the ground and perform its will and prosper. Then I heard a holy one speak, and another holy one said to that one, how long will the vision about the regular sacrifice apply, while the transgression causes horror, so as to allow both the holy place and the host to be trampled? And he said, for 2,300 evenings and mornings. Then the holy place will be properly restored. And then after that, we go on to the interpretation of the vision. But let's discuss this little horn for a second. So in chapter 8, they're giving us more detail. It's here for a purpose. It's showing the Jews that there's a significant event taking place here that is going to involve the Jewish nation. And that's why the vision of the ram and the goat. And it has to do with the little horn. The little horn here, I believe, is one of those dual prophecies I was talking about earlier. This is an actual figure that we learn to be Antiochus IV. And you wouldn't know this beforehand. You really wouldn't know from the prophecy who this figure would be until he actually appeared and performed the abomination. Now, there's a lot of history here, but we're just going to stick with what Daniel says here, how he came in, he came to the beautiful land, which is Israel, or Judah at the time. And it grew up to the host of heaven and caused some of the host and some of the stars to fall to the earth, and it trampled them down. Now, for reasons that we don't have time to discuss here, Antiochus came in, and with the help with a little bit of people from the Jewish faction that supported him, he seized control of Jerusalem. The Jewish name for that they called Antiochus was the Wicked. And he set about to destroy the Jewish culture and replace it with a Greek one. And in verse 11, where it says, it even magnified itself to be equal with the commander of the host, and it removed the regular sacrifice from him, and the place of his sanctuary was thrown down. Because he went into the temple, he committed the abomination of desolation. That is, a abomination is a whore. He went in, he sacrificed a pig on the altar, and the people erected a temple. It was supposed to be of Zeus on the altar in the Holy of Holies. But of course, you know, nobody knew what Zeus looked like, so the statue was a picture of Antiochus. And his face went on there. And it says in verse 12, on the account of the transgression, the host will be given over to the horn, along with the regular sacrifice, and it will fling truth to the ground and perform its will and prosper. So he does as he, you know, as he wills, man. He eliminates the Jewish culture and stops their sacrifice. And the reason this is a dual prophecy, and the reason they actually put this in chapter 8 here and talk about this little horn, is because of the reference to chapter 7, the little horn coming up after the 10 kingdoms that are obviously, we've seen from chapter 2, don't happen until the end times. And that is how the Antichrist is going to come in, and he's going to do the same type of activities and try to commit the same type of wickedness that Antiochus here did. So you just follow what Antiochus does here, and that's what the Antichrist in the future is going to do. One of the controversial verses here is how is starting in like 13, starting where it says, how long will the vision about the regular sacrifice apply while the transgression causes horror? That's the abomination, because he stopped the sacrifice and he, you know, sacrificed the pig and put up the statue there of himself on the altar. It says, while the transgression causes horror, so as to allow both the holy place and the host to be trampled. That's the temple and the Jewish people. And he said to me, for 2,300 evenings and mornings, then the holy place will be properly restored. So the 2,300 evenings and mornings, people try to put this in as years, but I don't agree with that at all. If you go to Genesis 1:5, it uses the same type of language in the Greek, where it talks about evening and morning as one day. And to me, the morning and the evening is one day. It's for 2,300 basically days. And if you follow Antiochus, you will find that when he stopped the sacrifice, and by time the Maccabean revolt had kicked the Greeks out and cleansed the temple, that's where they get their holiday of Hanukkah. And this 2,300 days comes out to like 6.3 years. And so it was around 169 that Antiochus took over the temple. And in 164, the Maccabees won their victory and took the temple back and started their sacrifice. Comes out to about 6.3 years. Now, if we move ahead back to where they're identifying the ram and the goat, starting in verse 23, you get more detail of what Antiochus does. In the latter period of the rule, when the transgressors have run their course, a king will arise, insolent and skilled in intrigue. And again, this is what the Antichrist will be like. His power will be mighty, but not by his own power, because Antiochus didn't come in through his own strength. He usurped it. And that's what the Antichrist is going to do. And he will destroy to an extraordinary degree and prosper and form his will. He would destroy mighty men and the holy people. And through his shrewdness, he will cause deceit to succeed by his influence. He will magnify himself. This is everything Antiochus did, which the Antichrist will do. Now, when you get to verse 26, it says here, but he will be broken, right before verse 26, but he will be broken without human agency. Well, Antiochus was not killed by humans or in battle. He died of disease. And the Antichrist will not be destroyed by man either. He will be destroyed by God. Now, the vision of the evenings and the mornings, which has been told is true, but keep the vision secret, for it pertains to many days in the future. And you're thinking, well, how do you keep it secret? He's writing it down. Well, the point is, the way the prophecy is explained, you have no idea who this person is. Daniel may have had a better understanding than what he actually wrote. I don't know. But we have no idea who this person would be until he shows up and performs his will. And I believe this pertains to the future of the end times, and that's why it's written this way. And I believe the little horn of chapter 7, which comes up at the end times, is the Antichrist. Chapter 8, I believe, goes into a definite, precise detail of a little horn that comes out of the Greek kingdoms that commits the abomination of desolation. I believe that is put in prophecy in chapter 8 to show us what the little horn from chapter 7 will do at the end times. Okay, the two people are different, but it's a prophetic dual prophecy to show us this is what's going to happen, Daniel, to you, your people, and your temple at the end times. That's why chapter 8 is there. And that wraps up Daniel chapter 8. And let's discuss Daniel chapter 9. Now, the book of Daniel contains the controversial sections of verse 24 to 27. And what we have here is Daniel seeing the same man that appeared to him in the vision previously. So we would say it's chapter 8 because Gabriel appeared to him in chapter 8, and he's appearing to him again in chapter 9. Now, Daniel was praying and studying the book of Jeremiah because he wanted to know when the exile was going to end. And upon studying, I'm sure he knew and came across that in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 25, verse 11, he saw that 70 years were decreed for them to be captive in Babylon. And they were to be captive there because this was retribution for their violation of the Sabbath laws. And so he prayed to God that God would honor his promise and bring his people out of captivity. And so you can read in verse 20, as Daniel was reading, the angel comes back and appears to him. And down at the bottom of verse 23, it says, I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed. And so the angel is going to explain to Daniel. He's going, look, Daniel, yes, 70 years have been decreed for your captivity in Babylon. But he's like, I got news for you. It's 70 weeks have been decreed. In other words, not just the 70 years, the angel's saying, but he's saying 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city. We find this in the book of Leviticus. If you look there at chapter 25, you'll find all the statutes of keeping the laws of God. And then you'll find in chapter 26, verse 18 to the end of the chapter, what happens if you do not obey his laws, which you're punished 7 times 7. So that's where they get 70 weeks equals 7 times 70. So if you times 7 times 70, that's 490 years. Now you might ask the question, why didn't God just say 490 years? Well, I'll tell you why. Remember, what he's teaching us and what he's showing us is very detailed, precise information. If he wanted it to be 490 years from start to finish, continually, he would have said that. But it's not from start to finish. It's 70 weeks in total. So there is a time, but it's a time that doesn't have a start and a finish. The angel is just saying, hey, look, Daniel, you're correct about the 70 years in Babylon, but there's going to be a total of 70 weeks decreed upon you that your people are going to have to go through desolations. If you read Leviticus 26, it's all about desolations upon desolations that Israel will be going through. So let's start in Daniel 9, verse 24, where Gabriel says, look, 70 weeks have been decreed, not just the 70, but 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city to finish the transgression. The transgression is an act against the law or a code or an offense. So the Israelites have transgressed against God and they have to finish it. They have to still finish the full amount of God's wrath upon them to make an end of sin. Well, we know that hasn't happened. We still sin. There's still sin in the world. You and me are sinners. So that isn't done. To make an atonement for iniquity, well, that's Jesus Christ. He was the sacrifice in place of, that's the atonement for us. To bring in everlasting righteousness, well, we know that hasn't happened yet. That doesn't happen till the millennium kingdom. And then to seal up vision and prophecy, that means the prophecies will be fulfilled and complete. There'll be no more prophecy when all this is done. And to anoint the most holy place. That's at the end in the book of Revelation, which we'll study about later. God brings down New Jerusalem with the new holy temple. Then the prophecy goes on at 25. So you are to know and discern that from the issuing of a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem, and we know that decree was done from the book of Nehemiah chapter 2, 1 through 8. If the decree was from the Persian Artaxerxes to rebuild Jerusalem. And it says, until the Messiah the Prince, that's obviously Jesus Christ, there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Now, here it subdivides the 70 weeks again. So you have a number 70 weeks, and it breaks it down into two sections. And it says 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Now, to me, that's an addition. It's saying 70 weeks, 7 weeks, and then you add 62 weeks to it. What is the 7 weeks? The 7 weeks, which is 49 years, is from the time they were told to go build the temple. At the end of 25, it will be built again with plaza and moat, even in times of distress. When you go to the original Greek of that, when it's talking about plaza and moat, it's talking about a city with total walls to defend itself, an army, a government. So it's talking about not just going over there and building the temple, but having its country back, having the Jews operating again. From that time on, Artaxerxes said they can do that. It would take 49 years before they were in that state. Now, also, this is the end of Malachi's, the last book of the Old Testament, the prophet Malachi's book, is finished. So it could be the end of that. And then also, every 49 years was a jubilee year. This could be the jubilee year starting again. That was God's law of all debt would be forgiven. That's why in God's system there is no inflation. Those can correspond for that first 7 weeks. He breaks it down, that 49 years. And then he says, and 62. So then you add 62 weeks would be 434 years, plus the 7 weeks, 49 years. And it's purposely broken down to show you a distinction between the two. It says that until the Messiah, the Prince, there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. It will be built again with plaza moat even in times of distress. So Jesus Christ will show up. It says, then after the 62 weeks, so you're talking 483 years, because you got, remember, the 7 weeks and 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off and have nothing. Of course, that's Jesus Christ dying, having nothing, meaning, you know, no heir. He's left to himself. And the people of the Prince who is to come will destroy the city sanctuary. So this is all going to take place against the Jews. In 69 weeks, the 7 weeks first, plus the 62 weeks is 69 weeks. All this against the Jews in 69 weeks, which has been fulfilled up to the temple being destroyed in 70 AD. That is all completed. And it says, and its end will come with the flood. Even to the end, there will be war. Desolations are determined. There's that desolations again, are determined. Remember, you can go read back in Leviticus. The desolations are being determined upon Israel over and over and over again. And the 70 weeks is the time allotted for Israel to continue its punishment, to finish its transgressions. Now, starting in verse 27, which is a very controversial verse, we have to determine the word he. And you determine that by using simple English grammar. He is a pronoun. When you use a pronoun, it's referring to the subject or something previously mentioned. So you go right to the subject. And that would be the previous person mentioned, which was the people of the prince that destroyed the city. So let me start at verse 26. Then after 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off and have nothing. And the people of the prince. Now, who is he referring to there? You don't know if it's Jesus or not, right? It just says the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. That's where you say, okay, you're not talking about Jesus there. He ain't coming to destroy the city and the sanctuary. Even though a decree and a punishment has been established by God, Jesus Christ ain't doing it. So obviously, this prince is another type of person who's going to destroy the city. And it says people of the prince. So who do we know after history that destroyed the temple? We know it was the Romans. You can even get more specific. The people, well, what legions were they using? They were using the 5th, the 12th, the 15th. And these were all legions drawn from the surrounding areas. So they were Syrians, Egyptians. I think the 5th was the Macedonians. So these were all peoples from those areas around Jerusalem that destroyed the temple. Now it says, these people are the prince. So we figure these are the Romans, correct? Who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary. And its end will come with the flood. Whose end? Its. Its is referring to the previous subject, which would be the prince of the people. Its end will come with a flood. Even to the end there will be war. Desolations are determined. So it's all going to come to an end because it's all been determined by God. Now it says, and he. Again, there's the pronoun. You go back to the previous subject, which is the people of the prince, which is this person who is of Roman descent. People destroyed the temple. This prince, he will make a firm covenant with the many for 1 week. And who's he talking to here? He's talking to Daniel. When he's talking to Daniel and he's using words like many and the host, they're talking about the Jewish people. He will make a firm covenant with the many for 1 week. So it's going to be his people that they're making the covenant with. Not all of them go for it. That's why it says many. And then it says, but in the middle of the week, he will put a stop to sacrifice and grain offering. Now, 1 week. What is 1 week referring to here in the context of this passage? It's 7 years. And it says in the middle of the week, he will put a stop to it. What's the middle of 7 years? 3.5 years. Where have we heard that one before? Talking of this person back in chapter 7. Remember, he's the little horn. He's the people of the prince. And it says, starting in verse 25, he will speak out. This is chapter 7, verse 25. He will speak out against the Most High and wear down the saints of the Highest One. And he will intend to make alterations in times and in law. And they will be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time. In the Jewish religion, a time was a season. The season was a full season. You go from spring all the way through fall back to spring. That's a time. That's 1 year. And it says time, times, so now it's 2 years, and then half a time, so now it's half a year. And again, this is the same reference to chapter 7, verse 25, time, times, and half a time. And speaking of the little horn, this same guy making a treaty with Israel. Now it says, in the middle of the week, he will put a stop to sacrifice and grain offering. You can only sacrifice when you have your temple. Well, the Jews don't sacrifice right now. They have no temple. So this tells us right here that the temple is going to be built. And on the wing of abominations will come one who makes desolate, even until a complete destruction. One that is decreed is poured out on the one who makes desolate. This person is none other than what we like to call the Antichrist, the future world leader, the little horn. He is going to destroy to an ultimate degree the Israelites and their nation. And he's going to fake them out with a covenant. And that, my friends, is Daniel 9. So what we learned from the book of Daniel, chapter 2, chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 9, is that there was four kingdoms on this earth that we're dealing with in the Jewish world and our world. The chapter 2, the long iron legs, is an empire that is not named ever in any of the chapters. We believe it to be Rome, and it goes on for a long, long time. I believe that's why it has the legs, until it eventually gets down to 10 kingdoms, which we know cannot be established to the end times. Let me show you that. You can go to Revelations chapter 17, verse 12. The 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings who have not yet received a kingdom, but they receive authority as kings with the beast for 1 hour. These have one purpose, and they give their power and authority to the beast. These 10 horns are the same ones from chapter 7. And it's the same as the 10 toes in chapter 2. We know at the end of the iron beast, be Rome, that the end of the age will come. The 10 kings are there, which is the 10 toes. It all fits in together. The pure theorist view that everything's already taken place is absolutely wrong. Remember, the Illuminati is working hard to bring around one world government. These 10 hoes, these 10 horns, it says in Revelation we just read, they have one purpose, give their power to the beast. Then in chapter 8, we see the little horn of Antichrist, who gives us a reference and a detailed pre-vision of what the Antichrist is going to do to the Jewish nation. And then chapter 9, we've seen 70 weeks decreed upon the people of Israel. These 70 weeks are broken down into three distinct sections. First, the 7 weeks, which was 49 years, been completed. Then the 62 weeks, which was 434 years, for a total of 483 years, been completed. and then 1 week left, which is 7 years, which has not been completed. And a lot of people don't believe this view, but I believe that God has decreed 70 weeks upon the Israelite nation. It's a certain amount of passage. It doesn't have to all come one after another. And this fits perfectly with the rest of prophecy. Because what does that mean? We're still in the iron legs. We're still at the feet where we're mixed with iron and clay. We can't unite this world. And the 10 toes aren't here yet. So where are we exactly? Let me explain exactly where we're at in prophecy. Well, first off, we're in the church age. The 483 years from Daniel has been complete. We just covered that. The 7 years that are left, the 1 week, has not come yet. That will happen later on. Now, in the book of Revelation, which we're going to get to next video, it is referred to this period as the sixth empire. Now, we call this period the church age, but in the Bible, it's a marriage contract. And the idea that is woven throughout the entire Bible is that Israel was the wife of God and Israel was unfaithful. You can read this in Romans 9, where Israel rejects God, rejects Christ. And Romans 11, from verse 11 to 31, it talks about how the Gentile nations are grafted into the family of God and the Israelites were rejected. But the Israelites will have a chance to be grafted back in at the end. That's the tribulation time. You can read about that in Romans. But what's happening in the church age is that in the Jewish times, when two people were betrothed to each other, there was promises made, gifts exchanged. There was a dowry paid for. And people could be committed to each other from infancy. And they would never consummate the marriage for, it could be 20 years. It was a long time. And in the meantime, in this betrothed period, the husband would be off working, building a house, getting his finances and his life in order, and get ready for the marriage that he was betrothed to this woman. The church represents the wife of Jesus, and we are in the betrothed period, or the church age. And this started at Pentecost. This starts the betrothal period. And it will go all the way to the marriage feast, which is in the millennium. This entire church age period is the betrothal. The dowry was made, a payment was made by Jesus Christ by his death. Now, the betrothal period is for the church to prove herself. In ancient times, the woman would prove herself and stay a virgin and be presented to her groom as a virgin. And that's what the Bible constantly, in the New Testament, constantly talks about, is this church, us, remaining faithful and being purified and purged so that only true believers are chosen and faithful. Be the true wife of Jesus Christ. You can find this in Ephesians 5, 25, 33, 2 Corinthians 11, 2, Ephesians 5, 24, Matthew 9, 15, Mark 2, 19, Luke 5, 34. Jesus is the bridegroom of the church. We are going through the betrothal period, and it will come to an end. Because Jesus said, when he ascended into heaven, he said, I go prepare a place for you. That's the ancient traditions that the Jews would do when they were betrothed. They would prepare a place for their wife. And that's exactly what is taking place right here. Paul even talks in 2 Corinthians 11:2 about Christ's jealousy. He's jealous for his church. Another example we can use, if you read Romans 7:4, Paul uses an analogy of a woman whose first husband dies. Then she's free to marry another. This is where we have become dead in the law, but through Christ, we may be joined free to him and bear fruit for God. Look in the book of Ruth. There's a symbolism there taking place. Naomi, who represents a Jew, Ruth, who represents a Gentile, and Boaz, who represents the Messiah. The whole story is how Jesus has bride to take in place of the other. So the point here is all the saints from Acts 2:1 to 1 Thessalonians 4:17 starts and ends the betrothed period. Now, in addition to this church age, which is proof over proof over proof throughout the Bible, that's exactly what we're in, Book of Revelations will call it the Sixth Empire. And let's talk about that. Now remember, four kingdoms on earth we've already discussed. Now this is Revelation 17. Let's start at verse 9. Here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits, and they are seven kings. Now we're talking about the great dragon with seven heads. And I'll get into more detail that next video when we talk about the book of Revelation. What I'm concerned about here, where it says there are seven kings, five have fallen. Okay, it doesn't matter what five we pick right now, they're gone. The next thing is one is. Well, John's writing the book of Revelation. It's in, 98 AD? It's in the Roman world. So the one that is the Roman world. And then it says the other has not yet come. So we are in the Roman time. This entire world is the Romanized world. Western civilization is the Roman world, the Sixth Empire. That's why we have long iron legs going all the way down to the feet until we get to the end times of the toes. This all fits perfectly. We're still in the middle of prophecy, right on God's schedule. We are the Sixth Empire.
And we are going to be here until the seventh and final empire comes and takes it over. We've already talked of the Iron Legs, which was Roman Empire. Now, the Roman Empire, as you see, it moves into the feet portion, which is the Roman Empire was assimilated by barbarian cultures, which became Western Europe, which became America, which became Latin America. Matter of fact, a lot of the Eastern nations also tried to emulate the Roman society and their culture and their tradition.
For example, after Rome, everybody fought over the emperorship. The French, the Germans, the Turks. The Turks even called their sultans in the beginning sultans of Rum because they believed they conquered Rome and Constantinople. The Kaiser means Caesar. The Tsar, Caesar. They even believe Khan means Caesar. The Holy Roman Empire. Everybody tried to emulate the Roman society. And we still
do today.
The
whole world is going to break down into these 10 nations or 10 unions, and you see that they're still mixed with the clay and the iron, meaning they will still be weak, they will still try to unite. Matter of fact, in Daniel chapter 2 verse 40 to 41, it continues into 43, and it talks about the seed of men try to unite, but they cannot. And that's the royal families, that's nations, governments, everybody's trying to unite their countries and merge together, but they cannot succeed. That is our world, still the Sixth Empire, still in prophecy. We cannot unite, but in the future, we are looking toward 10 kingdoms which will form up. These 10 kingdoms are going to form up not because of warfare or a nuclear holocaust, but because of economics. All of last video showing you that because of economics and our world leaders that the nations are going to merge together to be economically strong. Remember, Satan is trying to corrupt our minds, our lives, to turn us away from God. And he will never stop trying to destroy the chosen people, the Israelites. Because if he can do this, then he is going to turn the world against God. And to do this, he brings into our culture the sixth empire. Our culture is all part of the past empires. We have Roman culture, Greek culture, Persian, Babylonian, Egyptian. We use all their symbols. We use all their satanic rituals. We use all their seances, their spiritualism, their mysticism. We have indoctrinated our schools, our children, with this evil lifestyle. Believe it or not, it turns us away from the true belief of what God has intended for us. We use the alphabet the Romans gave us. We use the law, Justinian's code. We use the calendar. We use the Babylonian astrology, the study of the stars, the planets. All of these came from these past empires. And to use Daniel's vision of his statue, if I had to generalize what Babylon, the head of the statue, passed down to us, I would say immorality. It was the hub center of the world. It was the richest city in the world. Everything and anything you wanted could be found there. You can say it was the Las Vegas of its day. And it had so many religious festivals that we continue to use today. And it was a time to make money and to have fun. And that's what Babylon was. Persia, the next empire in the chest, passed down to us religious tolerance. They basically said to all their territories that you can worship who you like, you just pay your taxes, and you provide us with an army when we want to call upon you. This tolerance has been passed down to us. The Greeks passed down conformity and love of life. Every territory they went into, they created Greek cities. They encouraged the Greek citizens to live there and intermingle and intermarry. And really, though, on the backside, they were creating a monopoly of merchants, artisans. They had a banking system. They were going to pull all their resources to get rich. But to keep the people looking the other way was to keep them happy and let them go about their business and do as they please. So conformity is what the Greeks instilled, and complacency. Rome came along, and when they conquered the territory, they said, you are now incorporated into our realm. You can join our army. You don't have to defend yourself and protect yourself anymore. We'll do that for you. You just live here peacefully. And under our law, everybody will be judged equally. That's what the Romans provided, equality under the law. And this may sound good, the law condemns you to death. And our world, the U.S. government, is based on a judicial system with the world courts. Everything you do will be based on law. And as you know, the people with the money and the power can make the laws. Let me be clear that 95% of all the theologians, scholars, professors
either believe that the Roman Empire declined in 476 AD and that head was destroyed of the seven-headed dragon, and we're waiting for a revival of the Roman Empire, which is going to be 10 kingdoms that come out of Europe and will be the new Roman Empire. And then we have the other view of the Roman Empire was destroyed by 10 barbarian kingdoms, and they'll pick 10 kingdoms that they say these are it. Then the Pope comes up and he destroys three of the kingdoms, and he reigns as the false religion Antichrist until God returns. I don't believe with any of these. I'm saying that out of the seven-headed dragon, five have fallen according to the book of Revelation. One is the Roman Empire. That's where we're at today. The sixth empire, the church age, where the long silver legs down to the feet. And then when it talks about the ten toes will be set up, or the ten horns, which are both the same from chapter 2 and chapter 7 of Daniel, it corresponds with Revelation chapter 17, verse 12. The ten horns which you saw are ten kings who have not yet received a kingdom, but they receive authority as kings with the beast for 1 hour. These have one purpose. They give their power and authority to the beast. So the long iron legs down to the feet, the toes, is what we're going to form up. The world will form up into ten kingdoms for the Antichrist. So understand, we are the church age, the sixth empire, the betrothed period. We are going through the burning furnace and being purged to find true believers that will reign with Jesus Christ at the end. Look at Luke chapter 12, 35 to 40, the parable of the expectant steward, and Matthew 25, the parable of the ten virgins. These and others talks of Jesus Christ gone, prepared a place, and he will return for his church, his true believers.